Yeah, Rap Radar Podcast, Elliot Wilson.
It's B.Dot.
B.Dot, this is legendary, man.
I still can't believe we're here.
Courtesy of this man, Sean Jay-Z Carter. What's
y'all
up,
made
sir?
It. Cheers, yo, cheers. Y'all made it.
444.
They say big this time. Will never happen.
Yeah, big time. Y'all made it.
Wake me up.
Well, congrats, man. Like, I told people, man, you're my guy. I love you. You're my friend. I didn't know nothing about the album. Nobody believes me. And just to see you deliver at this stage of your career, like, on this level, like, we never seen it done in hip-hop. So,
absolutely.
First off, congratulations.
Thank you. Thank
How'd you do it?
Yeah, I really, like, you know, before I started this album, I even just studied, like, you know, not just hip-hop, any genre. Yeah. I studied Prince. I studied Michael. Bono had Beautiful Day. He was, like, 40, I think. Maybe 42. You guys could do, like, Googles and shit like that. Figure, but it's somewhere around there. Yeah, Beautiful Day. Just like from the beginning of someone's career and like making it, you know, that sort of album that really means something. Touches the culture. It's like a touch point. Like moves, have the conversation. Yeah. And just be really fucking good and
it's
shit.
It's a high standard.
It's like a hard thing to do because you're so removed from where you were in the beginning. And I really had to like, you know, think about what I wanted to say it was in this album at the time. I think about what was the next thing. What was the next thing I wanted to say? And I didn't want to just make an album, like, to put out some music. I wanted it to, you know, be important.
Right.
So it took me a minute to really get to that point. And then when I came to the top of this year, like, January 3rd was the first day I really, was the beginning of this album. We made, I want to say Kill Jay-Z and maybe OJ, like the first two songs. Yeah. And then I knew, I was like, okay, I got the feeling, I got the direction. And then just real life, I was going through so much stuff that I had to, like, I've always been that way. Like, just verbalize it in a way, it's like my therapy, making music.
Yeah, know? Does it bother you that people say, well, this is a personal Jay-Z album, like, you've never been personal before, right? Like,
well, I understand it. Yeah. I understand it because, you know, all those songs, like, it's a couple things happening, you know, and You Must Love Me is 1997. People don't know the people involved.
Mm-hmm.
So when you hear that story, you like, you're not really attached to the people. You don't really know them like that. You don't know my mom.
Brother,
you come to know these characters at this point. And then I've never been, you know, so open for so long. Usually it's like one song, two songs, three songs on an album. And then it's sprinkled in, you know, other songs. But for an entire album to make like 10 You Must Love Me, it's new, and it's like it kind of makes people uncomfortable too.
And speaking of mention 10, like the tagline on the album, I noticed is that you say this is his 13th studio album. Like, why was that important to convey?
I just thought I wanted everything to be in a real simple and honest place. You know, like, even the videos, you know, I don't want videos, like, music videos. Right. Like, each one is like a doc, or this is a short, or this is a, you know, even the cartoon that we made for OJ. Right. Like, I wanted it to be just an honest portrayal of everything that I was saying. Like, the story of OJ is about us moving forward. And for us to move forward, we had to take a look back. Mm. And we took a look back and say, okay, this is where we came from. And, like, this is real images. These were shot by Warner Brothers and all these, not to single them out.
Right.
These were shot by major studios. Like, these cartoons were on TV.
This
like,
imagery this was
people's,
right,
this
yeah.
imagery of how we were presented was this. And I wanted to draw a thread between that's really happening now. It's still happening. It's just not as overt. When you look at TV, you don't see a fair, equal representation of people of color. You know, when there's a show on TV, it's like this black show is on TV, or like, Insecure is on TV. It's like, oh shit, it's like a big deal.
Right,
you know
right,
what I'm
right.
saying? Like it's 2017, like 2017, and it's like that's a big deal. That should be an everyday occurrence because we are all like dynamic humans and creatures, and we haven't evolved past race still.
Yeah.
And it's like, still, nigga, like, that's, you know, those points are, like, real important to me. You know, I think that, of course, the headlines will be about being Kanye and things like that. But, like, this album has a lot of topics, you know. That's why it had to be so short. It's so condensed. Right. is so dense with subject matters and all these other things that if it was longer, you wouldn't be able to take it. It would, like, wear you out. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. It had to get to a point really quickly and be as dense as it is. And then No ID, what he's doing with the samples, he's playing samples like like jazz improv. No one's ever chopped records up the way those songs are chopped
Nina
up.
Simone
ask anybody,
records,
ask
Stevie Wonder
all
records.
The guys who do it. Ask, you know, pick a name. You know, ask all the guys who do it. The way this guy, his technique of way he's chopping it. So it's going to take you a while to really get to where the snare is dropping. Mm. It changes all the time. There's no four-bar loop. There's no repetitive loop on those songs. They change every four.
Why did that develop? Like, why was he always tell people, we ask, like, where's the Jay-Z album? I was like, well, Jay-Z necessarily doesn't produce. He needs a producer to kind of spark him. Like, usually your projects, there's that one producer
what happened,
that sparks you.
Yeah, from the beginning of this project, that's why I got co-production on, like, I guess more than half of the album. Because
that's the first time you did that, right?
Yeah, because No ID came to me with the technique. He was like, I got this thing. He called me back in October. I'm not great with dates, but he called me while, like, before we started this and was like, man, I got your next blueprint. I know he said something like, I know this is, like, a lot to say. And I was like, yeah, that's a lot to say. And just dismissed it. And then, you know, somehow we got up, and then we was in Rock Nation offices out here in L.A. And he played me what he was working on. I was like, oh, that's amazing. And he had, like, different samples. Like, he had sampled Dream and, like, these samples. And I was like, no. I got where we can take this. Mm. And then I made, like, a playlist. With, like,
that we put on title, right? So that's the actual playlist you
That's
gave
not him? The playlist I made for him, though.
Okay.
I made him a different one with more songs on it. I made him a playlist of all the things that, you know, I wanted to address and talk about on these different songs. So he chopped up the songs I sent him. Aside from, he already had 444, and he had Kill Jay-Z. And he had Family Feud. Mm. I think aside from that, all the songs that I bought him and we, like, worked them together. But he pretty much, again, I'm not a producer, so I'm not saying that I produced these records. I'm saying, like, the idea I brought to the table, and then we fixed the idea as we went along. That's why I thought it was important to have the co-production.
But why stick with that one producer? Because that's different for you, right? Like, you've never had just one producer anchor the whole project.
I think it was just such a... I had a sonic tone of where I wanted to go, and it just made sense. It made sense. We just I never got that involved in the production either.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Like, so it was just like him and I the whole way. Like, either I was calling him and saying, yo, grab the Stevie joint, or I got an idea. And then, you know, just working through the idea, like, It just felt like a collaboration.
Was this your first time, I guess, making an album in pieces? Because, like, you always talk about the blueprint was made, like, in a weekend or something like that. But, like, being that you guys stopped, came back, revisited, you know, was this, like, your first time doing it?
Yeah, we didn't really stop.
Okay.
When we really started, like I'm saying, when I came back from vacation, like, we talked about it, and it was, like, almost like pre-production.
Mm.
We were in the pre-production stage, October, and then, like, over the holidays. That wasn't really, you know, I came back January 3rd, we started. Things happened. Like, I think Dion's pop, you know, I don't want to say anything. But he said it, so I'm not saying anything I'm not speaking out of turn. Like, his dad had some complication. He went to Chicago, and then, you know, obviously, I've been a couple places, and then... some certain small things happened from January to when we finished. Which
was the,
like,
intent to get it out in April?
Yeah, originally? Just only because of the date. You know, it wasn't really. You know, that's why it moved so easily, because it wasn't about, like, a real thing. It was just like, let's get this out on 4/4 because it's 4/4/4.
You like that number?
That's stupid shit. Yeah. It's, you know, everybody has their things and in life and their. I hope, you know, things that you're drawn to or things that happen in your life. And, you know, that number's just been super present for me always.
How's it keeping a secret? Because, you know, the internet goes crazy. When is Jay-Z dropping an album? I'm sure you keep an ear to the street of what people are saying. Like, was it just hard to keep this under wraps? like that, or just wanted to?
We didn't go to any extraordinary lengths to keep it under wraps, you know. It's easier when you're working with, like, one person, you know. And even still, like, you know, people were saying certain things, and it was like, because so many rumors out there, you know, it doesn't matter these days, right? We're always working on an album, and, you know, so, you know, I wasn't so concerned with that.
But the massive market, like the 444, yeah. Like this rollout, like I know you're just as proud of this rollout. Like, talk to me about your mindset of, like, did you have this all kind of planned out, or did it I just come as a go? Like, to just how to present, how does Jay-Z present
had,
an album?
I had it rolled out, and we kind of, like, you know, moved on the fly. Because in the beginning, I just wanted to drop the title, which we did. We put out the 444 all around on buses and billboards and things like that.
But no one
like
knew what it was at first.
Yeah, well, I thought that would last longer. I was like, okay, we got 2 weeks when we drop this, and then we're going. By the night, it was on, like, the Channel 11 news. It was, like, everywhere. Like, CNN was like, I think Jay-Z's dropping an album.
It was one day. Nobody said nothing. Right. Then the next morning.
Oh, so that was the next morning.
Someone done the game, too. Yeah. It was, like, Danny Glover and a brother from Moonlight.
No, but before that. So before that, I just dropped the billboards, and then, you know, it got figured out in 24 hours. And I was like, okay, we got 3 more weeks. We got to think of some things.
No, but then
and that's where the Danny Glover thing came about. Oh, okay. So I was like, okay, let's be an asshole. Let's just throw,
let's just throw
a little curveball. Now, you don't know whether it's an album or a video.
So you
or
like
a film.
That, because it drove me crazy, but you like that. So you caused that confusion. It's your fault.
Yeah. Yeah. You want people to be surprised and happy when they get a project. You don't want people just sitting on it waiting, like, okay, here it comes, here's the project, right. So you know, I threw that curveball in there on purpose, and it didn't make any sense because it's bad marketing. Like, okay, everyone knows, and now you're gonna sit them over here. But I was confident that, you know, within the 3 weeks we'd be able to figure it out.
But how proud were you, I mean, of the rollout? Because everywhere you went, it was ubiquitous. Like you said, it was on the subway.
I think my best one. You know, with the team, myself and Willow. Me and Willow pretty much, I don't want to leave anybody out, but we pretty much, and of all the people that worked to get it done, obviously.
Is that Willow? Who's that?
Yeah, Willow, who's like a creative director. And,
and all the footnote stuff, that was all shot with Neil Brennan? Like, how did that all idea come together?
So... the idea was to shoot a docu. It was like one piece. Like, you know, all these pieces, like, that was going to be one piece. And then I figured it would better suit it to, because of these people and everything that was being said and the content we had and the honesty and vulnerability. Like, you look at it, it's like, oh my God, this is the theme. It needs to run through. So, yes, those pieces. Well, shot with different people, but Neil was the captain of it. Yeah, so just wind up being the thread of the whole project, which is a great idea. You know, it didn't happen like it didn't. It wasn't. We didn't think of it like that, but the way it happened was great because it gave each project a chance to be explained and kind of centered it and kind of put it in the place.
Do you
where
feel like it's almost like not fully appreciated because if you don't have title, you may not have seen certain things or like the, you know, in terms of the quality kind of like you see like an Anthony Anderson, a Chris Rock, a Will Smith, like you see some of the most
of course,
powerful
at
black
some
men.
Point, yeah, at some point, you know, it's bigger than any service, right? Because that's moving culture. That's like, that's a thing that's bigger than a title and a Jay-Z album, right? That needs to live somewhere. So at some point it'll go, we'll figure out how to, you know, package it and, you know, put it out to the masses.
But who rounded up all these people, though, all these different figures? Was it you? Was it someone you had in mind that you just wanted to round up, the, you know, the Chris Rocks and the Will Smiths and all these other guys?
Yeah,
in the
pretty
room?
Much all happened organically. Okay. Like, Neil was doing, he worked with Chris Rock, obviously, and a couple people. And then, like, people were coming through the studio. Like, Mahershala, like, he was, did I say his name right? He just came to the studio one night. He knows James, who's one of my friends, who's from London. He's Seal's brother. And he brought him by that studio one night, and I just played him some music. And he was like, especially Agnes, it had moved him in a way. Like, when I played that song, he was like, man. And we just had, like, and that was just what was happening in the studio. After we played the music, we have conversations for, like, 4 hours. Just about life. And I was... It's a strange thing. I learned more about the people I've been around during this process than any other, like, people I've known 20 years. I found out new things about them.
About Tata?
Yes. Wow. 100%. I'm not going to share that, but 100%. But I was like, oh, shit.
Wow.
You know, because I guess the what was happening and what was being said on the album allowed people to open up.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? It was like this cathartic process where people were just like, okay, well, since you shared that very intimate detail, let me say this.
Did you draw strength from that? Because here you are being the catalyst of it, right? And you're pouring your heart out and your soul and being vulnerable. Like,
yeah.
Did you draw strength from hearing others' experiences?
Yeah, yeah. And I knew, that's how I knew the album would be special in that way, because, you know, what happens in the studio usually transfers, you know, around the world. Mm-hmm. You know, I knew Niggas in Paris was a big hit because we playing in the studio. Everybody was like, that song, you know, same sort of thing. Like, everyone was like so open and honest and just, you know, talking through like life, like real life shit, that I was like, man, this is beyond music. This is gonna be important long after the album cycle. Like, we haven't seen, I don't believe, we haven't seen the importance of this album yet. Mm. You know, until it, like, really, you know, start manifests itself in culture and in society.
Puffy says it's your best
Everyone
album.
Everyone says it's your best album. Puffy, what do you say? I say,
is it Jay's greatest album?
I think so, man. And you know, I'm a Volume 2 guy, so...
As you, like, greatest? Got Volume 2 at number 1?
Volume 2 has been my number 1 since...
Let's not act like we haven't had this debate off the record.
Yeah, yeah, but I didn't realize that it was number 1, though.
Is
I know he
one?
Liked it.
That
he
was
said
always
one.
Number 1. No, we argue because I put Blueprint above Reasonable Doubt. You always... Reasonable Doubt is always number 1 to you. Yeah. So that was really the thing.
I think that it's definitely up there, and time will see what happens. Because, like, certain things, like, you can't tell, like... American Gangster age really well.
Yeah.
And, like, some
people love
it,
American Gangster.
Put it at one.
Yeah.
Like, it put it in top 5, top 3 a lot.
Yeah.
And it wasn't like that when it came out.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
No, no.
It just, it, like, grew. And then things like Blueprint 3 will go backwards because it had, like, big records on it. Mm. Run This Town and Empire and, like, Young Forever. That, as an album, when the record is that big, it seems, like, ubiquitous. It's hard to, like, just sit down and, like, you just chilling. I'm listening to New York. Stop screaming at me and shit. Like, I'm just screaming, man. I'm trying to drink some rosé. You know? So
that's what I liked about the 10 song thing, too, because I felt like some of the later albums were very top heavy to me, and then they didn't sustain as long, you know what I mean, in terms of the full length of
them. No, explain. What do you mean?
Like, I love, like, Blueprint 3 and Magna Carta to me, like, I love the first half of those records more than the second half.
Right, yeah, yeah.
Except Nickels and Dimes. I love Nickels and Dimes.
Yeah, yeah.
But I feel like that's what I liked about doing the 10 song thing. I don't think anybody expected that. And I think it also kind of, was it a conscious thing to kind of almost, even with the quality of how you recorded the vocals, like, you're not getting, it feels like you're not getting this big, massive Jay-Z return.
Yeah, yeah.
You're getting this kind of pure art.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, was that part of even the way you're
presented? And it just, even a lot of that was just the way it turned out. You know, like, some vocals I was just cutting inside the room, like, you know, to a handheld. Guru could tell you the name of the mic better. You know, just like shitty-ass mics. And I had, like, a cold for, like, a couple weeks. I had some mold. It was like a whole issue and shit, like drama. Like, one of these houses I had out here had some mold in the wall.
Wow.
And then, like, you know, we didn't know. So I go to New York and I'm like, man, I've been sick. I'm rarely sick. I'm like, I've been sick like 2-3 weeks. Like, and I've been recording. Like, you know, if you listen to
Moonlight, you said, right?
Yeah. And if you listen to the vocals on Smile, too, it was all these vocals. So it gave it like a vulnerability on its own. Like, these things were just happening as far as the vocal production. Mm. It was just like, I was just doing it. I was just, you know, because the idea came, trying to get the idea down and just leaving it, like, just the way it was. That's why it's not so, you know, polished. It's just like, you know, some things are here and out of the pocket, and then it's like behind the beat sometime, and it's like, yeah, I just left the shit the way it was. It's like in its purest form, like a conversation. You don't, like, put a conversation on beat. You know what I'm saying? Like, I know where the beat is, obviously, more than maybe anybody in history. I know that was like a lot.
other songs.
No, they challenge you on that because they say, well, does he still have the flow? Could he rap like he rapped with the same?
Well, I mean, if you listen to Marcy Me, you can listen to Marcy Me and see if, as far as flow, I think, you know, it was like a technical display of being way on beat and like acrobats to listen to it.
And the third verse of Smile.
Smile.
A little crazy. Yeah. What's going on there, man? You went in. Some MC shit, like.
Yeah. That was the only spot in the album that was like, you know, it was like a selfish thing. Like, just in case, you know, just rap really good and shit.
Just a reminder.
Yeah, like a little reminder. But, just feeling. Just going with the feeling of the song and not trying to. I didn't try to, I've obviously been doing this for a while, so I know how to make songs, you know, and it was less about making songs and more about just like raw expression.
Right. Are there any songs that, I guess, on a cutting room floor? Is everything that we've heard what was recorded?
Pretty much. It's like a song called Black Gold. That's, you know.
Black Gold?
Yeah.
Okay.
And part two, like this other song, which was actually the response to Kill Jay-Z before Bam came in.
Oh, wow.
That had this beautiful Al Green sample. A couple, but pretty much the ones that was on the cutting room or, you know, wherever, like, I put on the bonus.
Right.
Was it a tough decision to not put those on the album? Like, why did those records not fit the album?
Yeah, I just, again, I knew it was so many different real, like, subjects we were touching. Mm. Like, each subject is a five-hour conversation.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Like, just discussing about, like, all these things. Everything that I discussed on the album, like legacy, like your children and what happens after that, you can go on for days discussing that. So I didn't want the album to get so long that, you know, we missed out on what's important. So that was really hard to edit and keep the focus where it was, you know?
You talk about some of the subjects. I guess one of the reoccurring themes everyone's talking about is Black excellence, you know, Black empowerment, Black accountability. I mean, you talked about it. I think you, like, alluded to it on Murder to Excellence or the Watch the Throne album. Yeah. You know, you talk about, like, how it's only a few Blacks the higher you go, the higher you ascend professionally. Yeah. And on this album, you just took it tenfold. Like, what was that? Were you consciously trying to do that, just trying to get that message across?
Yeah, I've been trying to do that since the beginning. Mm-hmm. If you listen to Reasonable Doubt, that's there. Listen to your Black album. Listen to... What's the S. Carter mixtape? The first song that comes on is Young, Gifted, and Black.
Kane,
it's been a constant in my career. Mm. Not as concentrated and as prolonged, not as a theme for an entire project, but I've been doing that forever. Right. You know, so even Magna Carta wasn't the greatest version of it, but that was me trying to get there. You listen to Ocean with Frank Ocean, you know what I'm saying? Right. You listen to those songs, Fuck Up the World. Fuck Up the World could have lived on this album very easily.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? So
listen to Nickels and Dimes.
Listen to even the intro, the Pimp C talking on Fuck With Me, You Know I Got It.
Mm.
You know, what's important for kings like us. So don't down us for wanting things. It's just in our gene. Right. We from Africa. Like, all these themes were always there.
But you face resistance now in music because, let's just take it back, Magna Carta, the way you sold that record to the mobile company and Billboard didn't embrace that. Can you talk about that, what a turning point that was and how that shaped kind of the way you look at things and what success is in this era?
I just never subscribed to that. Like, I subscribed to always changing and being what, you know, some rules were made way before things were introduced.
Mm.
For the internet was introduced. We don't even know what's an album with consumption. 444 was downloaded a million times illegally. We gave it away. We gave away a million. But this is a thing. We're not throwing albums out to make numbers. You have to make an effort to say, I want this album. Now, that's a transaction, right?
Mm.
So, but back to my point, Billboard has no idea, and that's just no knock on Billboard, because they actually changed the rules after Magna Carta.
That's
true. If we keeping it 100% honor, I'm sure they'll tell you, like, the rules were changed in consumption because of Magna Carta and the way it was rolled out.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the rules will change again after 444. I believe that. And I'll explain that in a minute.
Yeah.
So we don't know what's consumption. Legally download a million times. We gave away a million and then sold another 200, whatever the number was, the next week. I think of 2.2 million records, like in the real people's hands. They can't even account for that. We don't know how people are consuming things today. Like, it's just all over the place. So for them to tell me what, I'm an artist. It's my music. I can do what I want with it. That's the one thing I get.
Yeah.
I get to present it to the world the way I like, right. Period. And whether they count or not is insignificant to me. It's like, it still happened. People still have the album. Mm. You know, I still made the transaction with whomever I made the transaction right. with. Yeah. So the money came in, the album went out, it touched people's hands. Whether you count it or not, it's insignificant. It right. still happened. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? People
does,
are still
but
listening.
But does the criticism bother you that the idea that maybe Jay, because he's in a successful position, he can get a mobile company to buy a million copies of his album.
Yeah, everyone
that's
could if they wanted.
People say you're cheating.
Yeah, but cheating what? Because what happens is even after I do what I do, the album goes number one by their traditional rules.
Right.
That's a number one album.
Right.
After all those records sold, that was enough to be number one on their traditional rules. Mm. So, okay, don't count that if you don't want it. They didn't, and I'm cool with that. They counted the number one album that came out when it was released to the masses. They still counted yeah. that. So all this 2 million records bootleg and then the million we gave away didn't count. Cool. How am I cheating? That has nothing to do with the real chart. Their real chart.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
But you still challenge that in a sense, right? Because like you feel it may not yeah. reflect what's
It doesn't.
Really,
okay.
What's the real metric?
So here's what I'm saying. I got $10 million for an album. I said, okay, with that $10 million here, I'm going to give it away. They don't count that. But the next week, they count free Spotify spins. That's what's happening now. That's what's going on. They're counting streams. They're counting that as a transaction. They're adding that to the consumption number, which is driving people number up. So that's why Tyler, he gets confused because everyone does because there's not enough information that Tidal cheated when it came to Meek or something like that.
Yeah.
All we did was say, if your label calls and say, I want to put my album pre-paywall, that's your choice. We say, okay, we'll put it out for free. We're doing what Spotify does every day.
So they count free streams right. on Spotify, you're
100%.
Saying?
That's
not
a fact.
Not just the premium. Got you.
That's a fact. That's a fact. In fact, they count it the same as a paid stream. Mm. That has to change, and that will change.
Yeah.
I'm sure of that.
So the only times Tidal's done it, I mean, I work for Tidal, full disclosure, obviously, but you're saying that these were unique situations where normally you don't put records in
we don't put any free, but if an artist says, I would like my album to go pre-paywall, we put it pre-paywall. It's the same thing as Tidal's, as Spotify's free tier. It's no different. Yeah. We're not using robots to jack. This is like fantasies.
Well, they were saying that the bot system can manipulate that if it's whatever.
Well, the bot system can manipulate Spotify, but we don't have a bot system. You know what I'm saying? But it doesn't even make any sense. But what we're saying is the same thing Tidal does pre-paywall, Spotify does every day.
Right.
And everyone's cool with it. That's another thing that I don't understand. I don't get that. It's like, you know, you have to really think about why that is. Why does Tidal take so much criticism for the same thing that Spotify does? Costs the same much as Spotify. Oh, it's too expensive. Costs the same much as Spotify. Oh, it's this. It's the same as Apple Music. Oh, this. You know what I'm saying? It's like, why is that?
You think it's personal?
To me?
Yeah.
No, right. I don't think anything's personal. I don't take anything as personal. Mm. It could be a lot of things. It could be, you know, I don't know. It could be like self-hate. We have that thing. You know what I'm saying? Like somebody that's like you doing, like your own people doing. I've seen that happen. Like LeVar Ball. I like to talk about other people so it's not a personal thing with me. LeVar Ball, he said, I'm going to start my own company. Everybody's like, you should sign a Nike.
Yeah.
Now he may go about things wrong. He may have
he
a big mouth.
With everything he says.
He may rub everything. Yeah. But I bought 3 pairs. Why did I buy 3? I didn't get them, you know what I'm saying? But that man, has a vision of his own. Why wouldn't I support him?
Right.
Why wouldn't I support him? He feels like he can move culture, and his son got a big enough name and a big enough brand that they can do it.
Right.
Nike had to start somewhere. Yeah. Why do we get so upset when us as a culture want to start our own shit? That shit is puzzling to me. Like I sit back and I'm like, this makes no sense. Like, why can't he start a sneaker? Oh, you dumb. Sneakers are terrible. Well, there wasn't any more terrible than... Now I don't want to... I'm not being negative for anyone. I've seen some bad sneakers from Under Armour. Yeah. I've seen some bad sneakers from... Nah, I've seen bad Michael Jordan sneakers. Horrible.
Yeah.
I mean, Michael Jordan obviously is the greatest at making... Yeah. Right. At some point, he was selling for Nike, and at some point, he broke away, and he started building the Jordan brand. I'm sure that was difficult.
Yeah.
And I'm sure people at that time when he was building the Jordan brand was like, you playing yourself. You going to leave Nike? Man, all due respect, fuck Nike, man. And I don't mean like personal. I mean fuck the thing. Like everyone has this reverence towards these things. Like, you know, I'm sure when we walked in, we started Roc Nation, and everyone looked and said Universal or Def Jam. And like, we built the brand. You know what I'm saying? Like, it can happen. We are culture. Nothing moves without us. We just continue to give it away. And it's cool. Everyone can participate. Nike still works with Jordan.
Right.
It's just the nature of our relationship has to change.
We have to feel like we can be empowered.
That's what I'm saying. Yeah. Our nature, and that's all this album is saying. I'm not against young guys or against old guys. I'm just like, yo, I didn't even tell people to stop using the money phone. I didn't say that.
Yeah, talk about that. I think of OJ, to talk about that record.
It doesn't say that anyway. So I had to listen again. Like, how is this being misinterpreted? Right. I just said it ain't money to us. It ain't.
Right.
That's just an honest statement. Money to us is me and my three friends on the floor at the Golden State. Not because the seat's expensive, but because that's what we doing. You never seen that. You know what I'm saying? That's... Or building brands and pushing it forward. And that can't be the end all. That can't be our goal to get money and then show it on the internet. That can't be our goal. That's some corny shit. You can do it. I've been saying this. Chains is Cooler Cop, but more important is Lawyer Fees. That's my first album.
Right.
I've always been trying to give people game and like, here, man, learn from my experiences. I'm not even saying I'm better than anyone. All I'm saying is like, yo, I touched that. I did that.
So you don't go through that.
Hov did that. So I can give you lyrics. I can do this. We can do this until night falls.
Yeah, right.
I've always went through things and said, yo, my man. And that's all I want to do for the young. I want them to be better than me. I want them to go further. I want to look back and be like, man, they took that baton and like, look what they did with it. And I know that ain't the answer. That's right there. That right there is going to lead to tax problems and, you know, you're not going to be around forever. Right. That ain't the...
Posting a big stack of money.
Yeah, that ain't the thing.
Flossing in that way.
Yeah, that ain't how you... Yes, have fun. I'm not here like the fun police and shit. Like, enjoy yourself. Go to strip clubs. But that can't be the end all. Is all this message I was conveying. Like, you know, it's just like we gotta take this power, put it together at some point. Damn, we never going to do it? Like, never. We just going to keep giving it away. We going to keep building Snapchat. We going to keep building Twitter. We going to keep building Instagram. And then, like, and then go to them and say, hey, man, give me a marketing deal.
Right.
Like, and they're like, no, I'm not giving you shit.
Right.
I'll put your album up for 24 hours. No, I'm going to album up for 4 months.
Right.
I built this shit. We built that.
Yeah.
And now we come back and we have to ask for things. We have to ask for the placement thing on the Apple. I don't have any problem. Me and Jimmy cool. Like, me and Jimmy was here last week in this very place. I don't have any problem. I don't have a problem with Lucien. We speak. But I got to tell the truth.
Right.
I got to tell the truth. And if they understand it, then we can continue to be friends. Right. And if they don't understand that truth, then that ain't really on me. That's just how it goes.
Right.
I got to continue to tell the truth. I got to keep pushing forward. I got to represent for us. I'm going to always represent for us. I've always represented for us.
Right.
What's the Cold Crush line?
Do you feel... No, sorry.
Overcharging niggas for what they did to the Cold. Yeah. I meant that.
Right.
I meant that. That's how I sit right here in the same place. Everything I said then, it's just that now I have a bit more power.
Right.
I have a bit more... Not even power. Let's not say that. I have a bit more... experience in the game.
Impact. Were you surprised that the story of OJ line about Jewish people in real estate was met with some resistance?
Kinda. To that point, it's hard for me to like take that serious, because I've exaggerated every black image in the world.
Right.
And if even you as a Jewish community, if you don't have a problem with the exaggerations of the guy eating watermelon and the, you know, all the things that was happening,
the symbolism,
if you don't have a problem with that and that's the only line you pick out, then you are being a hypocrite, and that's I can't address that in a real way. I gotta leave that where it is, right? Because it was like exaggeration. So that was, of course, I know Jewish people don't own all the property in America. That's not even, I own things. Yeah. So, and then, you know, so I know they don't own all the property in America, but it was an exaggeration, much like that.
They do got Williamsburg on lock, though.
Yeah. Yes. I could have said a lot of property in America. That's just a fact.
Right.
I pretty much said, if you want to be good at property and these things like that, follow this pattern. This is what they did. It's almost like saying Kobe Bryant shot a lot of shots. If you want to be good at basketball, practice, shoot 1,000 shots, and do what he did. Yeah. And that fight, and then Kobe Bryant comes out and says, "What you trying to say? All black people play basketball?"
Right.
That's how ridiculous it is. Right. It's like, no. I mean, you know, I didn't say that. I mean, context is everything. Right. And the context of the song clearly outlines what I'm trying to say, and the point that I'm trying to make is actually, you know, you guys did it right.
Right.
You know, and the reason I believe, my beliefs only, is why Jewish people got it so right as a community is when they left, the people that got out, you know, after the war,
right,
were here by themselves. So they were forced to band together.
Mm.
They, like, someone tried to kill off their entire race. Can you imagine, kill off the entire race? So they had no choice but to band together, and they worked together, and that working together helped them to get a power system, a power base within their own community.
Right.
I lived in Marcy. I seen when there was a Jewish community was built on Lee Avenue. It was two blocks.
Flushing Avenue.
It's two blocks.
Right.
It's a beautiful community from across the street.
Right.
Directly across the street from Marcy Projects, all the way to the bridge.
Right.
So I seen what was built by a small community of people working together.
Right.
That's what I'm trying to tell our people. Like, I seen that happen. Everyone in Marcy and Brooklyn can attest to this. This is a real thing. Mm-hmm. This is what,
that was 30, in our face. Yeah.
It's 30 years. It's not. That's no time. I had an album that's 21 years old.
Wow. Right.
You know what I'm saying? That's no time. We can really do that. I've seen it happen. And that's what I'm saying is, yo, we can build some shit together.
Right.
You know, not. And then it's funny how people will take that song about that and then make it about a money phone. It's like, how insecure are you, man? Like, what's wrong? Like, what's happening? What's really going on? Because I'm not saying that at all. Like. Right. But I guess that's the time we live in, like sensationalism and, you know.
But is that also just a gift and a curse of the power of what Jay-Z says something? It's a statement.
It means
anything you say in this interview, all of a sudden now is a CNN headline. You're at that level of career. Is it almost like a gift and a curse? Because you want your voice to be loud and impactful, but at the same time, people may not always connect the way you want.
Yeah, I have to tell the story as clearly as I can, and I'm going to catch the people that I catch. And then some people, they're just not ready.
Yeah.
You know, there's times in my life where I wasn't ready to receive information. Mm. Sometimes you're just not in the place, no matter how clear it is or what people are saying, to receive information. I remember going to a club with Biggie and him, a guy being out, told the story. Yeah, I just wasn't ready to receive the information.
He thought he was a punk for wanting to go in the club.
Yeah, not guys outside, he's like, I'm not going in the club. I don't want to deal with that. And I'm like, what? Let me out. I've done dumb shit. Shit was dumb. And I'm telling people, like, yo, I've done dumb shit. Don't do dumb shit.
Right.
You know, I mean, do dumb shit, but be better than me and be smarter than me. And here's the information. Here's the roadmap so you don't get caught in the same situation. That's all I'm saying. So you don't get caught in the same situations I'm caught in. I got caught in. Mm. Here's the roadmap. Here's the breadcrumbs.
Right.
Here it is. I'm giving it. I've asked anyone. I've been doing this not just on record, behind the scenes. I've spoken to everyone. Mm. I've kept like information. That all the information I have is for everyone.
You're not selfish with it, right?
No, I share it all the time.
You shared
all the time
at the B-side show. I remember you said like Pharrell told you to go with the safety net. You know, someone dangled a crazy check. Like, what made you say no to those things? Because and what were you talking about in general? At the B-sides, freestyle, yeah. That little freestyle that you put out?
You know, Pharrell, he's a brother of mine. He loves me, you know what right. I'm saying? So he sees the obstacle that is, you know, at the time, Apple. This is Apple, man. Like,
so they came to you?
They got like $1 trillion, man, or more, right? Like, how are you going to... You can't. It's hard to see. That's hard to see. Like, how are you going to even get started? There's
but,
no way...
But Apple came to you with what? Like, an offer to for title?
We had talks. We had talks about... how to work together.
Okay.
Before I started Tidal.
Oh, wow.
But the talks were about different variations of what I was doing. Mm. And I was like, no, this platform needs to go up because people need to have, you know, I think it's important for us to share in some of the things that we move.
Mm. Right.
You know what I'm saying? I think it's important for us, even if I at some point fail, that people see, like, maybe the next person to look at the things I've done wrong and then say, okay, you know, like that terrible press conference, you know what I'm saying? Like, I would never do that again, you know? Right. The launch of the,
right,
the
title
thing.
Launches,
you know what
right,
I'm
yeah.
saying? Like, it's things like that that I've done wrong that
what,
I wouldn't
what was
do
wrong
again.
About that?
I don't think it was wrong.
I thought it was like a bunch of big artists complaining about money and it wasn't even about that. You know what I'm saying? Had we had time, you know, the reasons, then I just do things for different reasons. The reason why we had to rush and do that is because, you know, I got the company and it had my name on it. Mm-hmm. And I didn't want it to be about me. You know, I wanted it to be about all the people, all the owners, mm-hmm. Everybody that owned it. So I tried to rush that and it came out on a bad note. Mm-hmm. As opposed to saying, you know, just let it be what it's going to be and then
right.
we just do it right.
Yeah.
You know, that was a powerful lesson for me. Like, no matter what, I'm not. Mm-hmm. Don't let anyone rush your process.
Mm.
You can't. It's going to always look like that. It has to be how you, when you're ready. And then you just tell a story. Even if the story got out that, you know, I bought the company or whatever, I can always tell this story. And it didn't change anything, right? No matter what, everyone owns the company. They still say Jay-Z's title,
right?
You know what I'm saying? Like,
I also feel like when it wasn't instantly successful by whatever gauge, right, then people think, well, Jay-Z's a businessman. This is just like he's no longer the owner of Nets. He's just going to sell this. He's just a businessman. He's going to flip this.
Like a money grab.
Is he really committed to this, you know?
Yeah, that's fair. That's because I am a businessman, and that's fair to say. And but I've never lied. You know what I'm saying? I've been wrong, and I'm just like, don't sit in front of people and lie about my intentions. You know,
right.
When I say I'm going to start an agency because black people are being taken advantage of, I do that. I do just that.
Yeah.
I never lied to the culture about my intentions or what I was trying to do. I've said it very clear. I'm raping Def Jam. I'm a 100 million man. I told you that. You know what I'm saying? I'm overcharging people for what they did to the Cobra. I told you I was going to do that.
Right.
I said it, and I did it. You know what I'm saying? I'm not. I don't.
Came a little short in that Live Nation renegotiation, though.
Yeah, but that was the third one, by the way. Thank you for that. Ali, you let me floss. That was the third. This is the third.
You might hit that number, Free King's number back then.
Yeah.
That remember I hit him, B-Dot was like, yeah, I apologize to B-Dot. I didn't really get that number.
Yeah. This is the third deal.
It's a $200 million, you bum ass nigga.
Yeah.
But oftentimes you looked at as or painted as a shrewd capitalist and things like that. Does that bother you? And also, there's moments of black plight in the community. You know, people often turn to you as a scapegoat. Like, do those things bother you when things like that happen?
I mean, it's part of the job. You know what I'm saying? If I look back and I say, you know, this is going to happen in my life and these are the things that I have to deal with. I look at the things that I have to deal with and be like, yeah. You know, it is what it is. And
right.
that's part of it. That's part of being successful is that people are going to look at you. It's no matter what you do.
Right.
Like I did Brooklyn, the Nets, for instance. I didn't take any money. I took like the smallest piece. I took just for Brooklyn to put that back. I created those. Me and my team. Mm-hmm. I'm not saying I. Me and my team created those uniforms. I mean, we didn't get paid for that.
Mm.
You know what I'm saying? Then everybody turn around and say, you made a terrible deal. you can't win. You know what I'm saying? When, right. when you do something and don't take the money and do it just because I come from Brooklyn, I love Brooklyn. I want to see a team in Brooklyn. I did it for that. I didn't do it for the money. And then people would say, the same people who said, oh, he's all about money, would then turn around and say, you didn't get any money. It's like, you can't have both of these bags, right? You know, at least for this time, say, oh, this time he did it for the borough. He didn't do it for the money. You right. can't have it both ways. But so you can't control that. I can't control.
But you gave up
the I can only control my actions. Mm. And then after that, what happens is people's, and a lot of times people interpretation about what you're doing is not about you. Mm. It's about them and where they sit in their life and how they view it through their lens. Mm. You know what I'm saying?
Right. Because if something happens in Brooklyn, you know what I mean, whether it's, you know, socially, economically, what's Jay-Z doing? That's often the conversation. I'm like, but, you know, Jay-Z's not your scapegoat. You know?
Right. So. And then if I do something like Jay-Z's...
he's a media whore. He's
He's doing that so people could look at him. It's right. like you can't win in those situations. So it's best to do what you truly believe in and have 100% pure intentions and then let the universe figure it out. You know, at the end of the day, I think when people look back on everything I've done, you know, it's going to speak for itself. Right. There's no need for me to even get upset about right. that or try to fight it. You know what I'm saying?
Makes sense.
Or even speak about it. You asked me it. So
right. You mentioned like therapy and you mentioned spirituality. Like how much of that has been increased in your life and has also helped you keep that balance to not allow that?
Well, therapy has increased my life just recently. It's like four years now. But music has always been my therapy. Right. And I've always been a spiritual person. You know, I think in legacy is another thing that, you know, again, another one of those subjects. I touch on legacy and what happened to me as far as like my grandfather, you know, what he was doing with his daughter. And he was a pastor. Mm-hmm. And it's like, I got to forgive that as well. As hard as that is, it's like, man, like that's deep for me. But what happens is, this is called transgenerational trauma, right? Mm-hmm. Like what happens is it informs who I am today. Because something about him wasn't right. So I was like, man, people in religion are hypocrites. Mm. So I sought out religion to say, okay, maybe I'm not a Christian. Let me see, maybe I'm, you know, God body.
Right.
Right? Okay. Maybe I'm a Buddhist. Mm. Okay. Maybe I'm Muslim. So I got a bit of, and then realized, oh, I'm just a spiritual person. Because if you walk into any one of these places, you walk into a mosque, a church, a thing, it's an altar. Mm. That's constant. There's God, there's an altar. Mm. You know what I'm saying? Like, so, okay, that's what aligned for me and my spirit and my soul was I'm a spiritual person. I don't know everything that's out there, and I'm fine with that. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. I know God exists, and I'm cool with that. But that I was informed by that because of what the actions that happened with my grandfather. And, you know, so and like going to therapy and like just allowed me to see that clearly and just really put things in place like, oh, I know why this triggers me in this thing because this happened. And, oh, shit, that's why. I ain't just wake up one morning with an idea to, you know, study the Quran. You know what I'm saying? It came, where did it come from? Why? Why if everyone in your family's Christian, why aren't you Christian? It's just natural. Like if you were Democrat, why?
Right.
Because everybody you grew up with is a Democrat. You don't ask the question. You know what I'm saying? But because there was some trauma there, it led me to ask the question. I went everywhere and asked the question. Why is it that? Why isn't this guy living up to what he said and who he said he is? And then going somewhere else and being like, okay, why doesn't everything in that religion check out? Why doesn't everything in that religion check out? And for me, it was like, oh, okay. God exists.
You know what was that process like for you to embrace therapy? Did you know right away that this was helpful to you from like early sessions you had? Did you
not
feel right
really,
away?
Not really, because when I first went to therapy, it was like a probation thing.
Oh, with the un thing, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Oh.
And I hated it. The lady was giving me tea and shit. And that's why when I saw Get Out, I was like, oh, shit, she had me fucked up. She was giving me tea, and she rang a little bell at the end when it was done. I was like,
just get out?
Yes. I'm dead serious. I'm not lying to you. Like, she, and I always left it feeling like, separated. But I don't think I was ready for, you know what I'm saying, that kind of that level of getting to know yourself. Mm. That's the most difficult thing to do. It's easy to get to know other people. Like, get to know yourself and, like, really, like, know yourself and really ask yourself the question that you don't want to hear. You know what I'm saying? The things that you've done. That's how Kill Jay-Z came about. The things that you've done and what role did you play? It's easy to say, everybody's doing this to me. People are saying that I'm this capitalist when I'm really just trying to, like, inspire the culture and bring all my family with me and all my friends. Their whole lives is change. You know what I'm saying? Right. But it's easy to say that. But then ask, what role do I play?
Right.
I play a role in that too. I'm the one saying 1 million, 2 million, 3 million, 4. So if a person thinks that's what I'm all about, yeah, I can get that. If you just heard that, if you didn't take a deep dive into what I'm saying and with the proper context, you may think that's all I'm all about. So I have to take ownership in some of the things that I've said as well, to let to that decision of why people think that. You know what I'm saying? Or why people, whatever. But you understand what I'm saying.
Yeah,
about,
right? No, even with that with Kill Jay-Z, when you were addressed to Kanye, it seemed like you're addressing Kanye. It seemed like you're also holding yourself accountable, like how you view things, right? It's not just about singling out.
Think about that.
Like,
think about how I got to that point. It's not even about Kanye. It really isn't. It's just his name is there, right? Because it's just honest. It's just true through what happened. But I'm saying the whole point is you got hurt because this guy was talking about you on a stage. But what really hurt me, you can't bring my kids into my wife into it. Like, Kanye's my little brother. He's talked about me 100 times. He made a song called Big Brother. We've gotten past bigger issues. But you brought my family into it. Now that's a problem with me. That's a real, real problem. Now we have to, and he knows the problem. Because me and him would have been talked about. We'd have been resolved our issues. Because he know that he crossed the line. I know him. He knows. He knows. Yeah. I don't even, he has to know. I know he knows. Because we've never let this much space go between one of our disagreements. And we've had many. It's part of who we are. Just part of, that's what I like about him. He's this honest person. He's open and he'll say things and he's wrong a lot of times.
Right.
But we'll confront it.
And you never try to make him
this
who
one,
he wasn't. Yeah.
This one, but that's not the point. The point is, I was getting to a point where I said, you got hurt by that. That's nothing. You can't diss somebody saying you got hurt. That's the softest diss of all time. you got hurt because you did cool by right. This is myself back actually. Like, what are you talking about? You suck ass nigga. Like, what? Right. You know what I'm saying? Like, it's the softest shit of all time. So you got hurt because you did cool by yay. And they say, you got a knot in your chest. That little knot, imagine how unfelt. You stabbed it with like a real object, like a real knife, with a real physical thing you've done. You got a knot in your chest. Imagine how a knife hurts. So it ain't even about a Kanye diss.
Right.
It's not a diss. It's really, I'm talking to myself the whole time. I'm not talking about Kanye when I say you dropped out of school, you lost your principles. I'm talking about me. Mm. The whole thing. Look, Kill Jay-Z. They'll never love you. You'll never. Sean Carter's telling Jay-Z, you'll never be enough. Let's just keep it real. Fuck Jay-Z. I mean, you shot your own brother. This is my conscience talking to, having this, you know, this conversation.
Like
right. How can we trust Jay-Z? You shot your own brother. I mean, just Jay-Z. Daddy, you know you all the truth. You know these things in your soul. Like, you know when you're doing wrong.
Right.
You know you all the truth to all of you. You got people you love. You so this is what you've done.
Mm.
You know what I'm saying? Yeah. You dropped out of school. I'm talking to myself. You dropped out of school. You lost your principal. You got people you love. You know, the whole thing is me talking to myself and then taking ownership for some of the things that I've done.
And it could be other perspectives. It could be maybe the family looking at you with the problems and getting things right with your wife and how people may view you. Like, what kind of man is this? Like, is he a man that's going to
reconcile us? Well, that's a vibration or a reverb of the action. But the real song is about Sean Carter talking to Jay-Z, killing off the ego at the beginning of the album so we can have a different kind of conversation.
So what's this 20 million?
So now nothing is off limits. Let's strip it down. Let's take the mask off. Let's stop bullshitting and let's talk about
this ain't
some real
the regular
shit.
Jay-Z album.
Yeah, exactly. Set the tone and we're going to talk about some real shit. And it's not going to all be great.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to hold myself accountable. I may hold other people accountable too.
It's not all lemonade
that's a small part of the album, an important part, but a small part of the album. You know what I'm saying? And the 20 million shouldn't have been said, you know, that sometimes, like, you know, you go too far with that. That's a personal thing between him and I.
Okay.
And he knows. And I know. And that's all that's but nothing was off the table.
Right.
So I'm not even gonna say it's a mistake. Nothing was off the table for this album.
But the onstage rant stuff really did anger you, because you saying B was mentioned, that was
and my being child crossed. Like, even his child, you don't put our kid in that space. Like, don't talk about anyone's kid on stage, you know what I mean? It's too much energy, too much people, and you give room for anybody to comment. Our kid, our children already are in this place of where they are affected by our celebrity. Don't go doing something that allow people to pit us against each other and talk about my child, talk about his, even his child. Like, you know, don't do that.
But to be fair, you know, people are saying that you mentioned Future, and was that a play on words or?
Yeah, well, yes, that's okay. That's fair. That's really fair. I thought about that line, and I thought about hip hop, and I was like, I really don't mean any malice. What I mean by that is, the way his situation plays out, because he's such a public figure, my mind would have played out that way and maybe four times more. It, like, his child is in a loving environment from what I see. I don't know.
Right?
So I'm not, like, discrediting step pops in the whole world. You know, it was just it was a line to say that could happen to me in my future. Just so happened his name was Future, and then I just made a scheme out of it.
Right.
It was more so of a rapper thing.
Right.
And I thought about it, and I was like, well, I don't mean any malice. I don't, there's no malice in what I'm saying. Like, that was really my fear. You know, and another way where I have to mature.
Right.
I have to mature in that space where I'd be like, as long as my child's in a loving environment, I have to, you know, move on.
Right.
Better than the toxic one if me and my wife are not getting along. That's a toxic environment.
Right,
yeah. I wouldn't want my kid in a toxic environment. And again, that's a recurring theme, because in Mini Face Guard, I say it again,
right,
like,
right,
you know, in talking about the child support, getting $2 million in child, like, you know what I'm saying? Like, the whole, that whole thing haunts me, you know? So I have to, as you see, it's a constant, common theme, and it wasn't about trying to put Future now. I wouldn't even, that's just doesn't make any sense. We just made a song together. I don't have any problems with him. I don't have a reason to try to embarrass him or anything like that. It's just a rap thing, and I think we're so sensitive with rap too. I thought about that too. I'm like, man, you can't say anything. Like, Big was saying, like, I fucked RuPaul before I fucked the ugly ass skater. Like, I know he didn't. He liked them. He liked their music. He really used to listen to their music. Right. He liked that shit. You know what I'm saying? It was just like a good rap line. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
We've gotten to a place where you can't even say anything anymore. Like, you say anything in rap, you gotta apologize. Yeah. Like, it's like, yo, man, it's rap music. Like, fuck, man. Yeah. Like, shit.
But how much of the Kanye conflict is about business also? Because it seemed like he's not in a good position with Tidal, and like, he was talking about wanting to do an album with Drake at Apple and all that type of stuff.
I don't care about that. That's Kanye's decision. It's always been his decision. You know, I've never held anybody back in my life from doing anything. You can't name one time like I hold people back from what. I wouldn't do that. Like, I don't. It's not who I am. And nothing about business. It's all about that night.
Yeah. But it seemed like, didn't you guys meet at the top of the year? Like, there was a thing that you guys came over the house or whatever, you tried to have meet. Like, why hasn't this been reconciled the way maybe past situations were able to be reconciled?
I think because it's like, it requires a real conversation. And we'll have it soon. I'm sure we'll have it. It's just like, you know, when you've done something, like, and we've all done. I'm not saying I'm innocent. I'm sure there's things where he felt like I crossed the line and I went too far, and like, maybe I should have, you know, done things differently as well. I'm sure. I'm sure. But it's a conversation that we gotta have. Again, it wasn't just that nothing was off limits this album. Just
but do you feel like when you addressing in the music, there's rumors he may address in the music. Like, would you feel a way about that?
No. The guy made Big Brother. I put it out on my album, my label. I might have been the executive producer of
that
album. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
Like, I've always given people, not given, I've always allowed people the freedom. Ask anybody who worked, like J. Cole, ask Vic Mensa. I've never meddled in people's project.
Right.
That don't mean anything to me. Kanye makes a record, then he makes a record, then we'll deal with that from there.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Just one final thing on that. Do you feel like he may feel like on a personal level, like whatever drama his wife in Paris with robbery and things like that, or maybe weddings and stuff, you didn't go to his wedding.
Yeah,
like,
that's what I said.
Take those feelings like against you, but you weren't supportive of his family structure.
Of course, that's what I said. I'm sure there's things that it's a conversation. Well, you know, this ain't the place for the conversation.
No, I got you. Understood.
Yeah. Being talking about how, you know, reconciliation, like how did you and Solange get to a better place? We all saw what happened in the elevator private moment, but how did that happen?
Yeah, I knew you were gonna ask.
I mean,
we've always had a great relationship.
Right.
You know what I mean? I fought my brothers and like argued my brother my whole life. Mm. You know what I'm saying? Just so happened who we are, these things go into a different space. But it ain't nothing. We've had one disagreement ever. Mm. Before and after, we've been cool. You know what I'm saying? It's like my sister. Mm. I will protect her. It's my sister. Not my sister-in-law, not my, my sister.
Right.
Period.
What do you think when people say that three great albums came out of this situation, for better or for worse? Does that bother you? Does that,
I think we went into the elevator great artists. You know what I'm saying? I don't think that surprised me. You know what I'm saying? It didn't surprise me. I've always loved Solange music. I think she was slept on until this last album. I think the album before was amazing too. Yeah. Incredible artist. I think B made an incredible album before. I think I'm 100 of them.
Right.
She got
literally,
a lot of hits.
She literally has 100 hits. Yeah. So you know what I'm saying? Yeah. It ain't like she didn't have music before this last album. It sounds good. It's a good thing to say. Yeah. Like,
no, but you can make the argument that it's each one's best album. You can make the argument that it's B's best album, it's Solange's best album, best album.
Again, it would be an argument.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? It wouldn't be clear. It would be like, I don't know. I kind of like Reasonable Doubt. I like shit is kind of hot. Right. You know what I'm saying? Like,
the guy's pretty good.
We've made good music.
But honestly, when that footage came out, what was going through your mind like?
Yeah.
At the time?
You know, me, I'm a person that, always believed that my karma is like immediate. You know what I mean? So I trust life. Mm. And I don't shy away from anything. It's just like, you know, you feel like, damn. But then you deal with it.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Right.
But you said it was the toughest thing. You said in one of the footnotes it was the toughest thing you ever had to deal with. Fuck all that street shit. Mm-hmm. Fuck motherfuckers shooting at you.
Yeah.
Feeling like that rush. Like, this is the toughest thing you've dealt with in your life.
Again, like I said, you got to deal with your family. And then you got to deal with yourself.
Mm.
You know, self-correction. And that's the part. And it's hard. And most people give up in that space. You know what I'm saying? That's why it's like a 50% divorce rate or something like that. Because people can't work through that shit. You know, their ego or whatever won't allow them to, like, just submit and just be like, okay, you know what? I'm going to do whatever I got to do. And I got to figure this out.
Mm.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? It's a very difficult thing to do, I'm telling you.
But is it hard?
But it's worth it. It's way worth it.
I mean, I'm not married, but is it hard?
Don't make me cry, B-Dot.
Shut up, Elliot. Putting all this poker face, you know, being in a high-profile relationship and, you know, making sure everything looks good in public, but, you know, when doors get closed.
Nah, it's just life. And it's no such thing as making sure everything looks good in public. Like, you know, people got cell phones. It's impossible to make, you know what I'm saying? It's impossible to craft an image so well that people don't catch it on. This world is nuts. No, it isn't, cause I don't put any stock in that type of shit.
Mm.
That shit, it is what it is. You be famous, that ain't me. Mm. I know it's not me. You think I think I'm sitting here like it's no, it ain't me. It's the position I occupy, the space, the energy that I occupy as this person who made this work. So I occupy space that did draw some interest.
Mm.
It's not about me. When I move and I go on, someone else will fill the space. It was Big Daddy Kane and Rakim and all these other people before me, and there will be others after me. It ain't about me, so I don't put no stock in that. That is what it is. Fame comes and goes, you know.
Right.
Real shit. You pay attention to that fame if you want, and your real life suffer, and then when that's gone, you don't have anything.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? So it's important for me to like be real, get my real life together. Be a real present. You know, high integrity person in real life. And I worried about what's on TMZ and shit like that. Shit don't mean they, by the way, it's not even personal to me. You know, they don't dislike me. They don't know me. You know what I mean? They know that if they put this clip, this clip may make it there, right? If they put this clip on at this certain time, it's going to draw this many viewers. That's what it's about.
Right, right.
It ain't about me. So I don't... the long answer is no.
what was it like, though, before you have your moment with 444 to address things, to step back and B has Lemonade, and this comes out and this shakes up the whole world? What is that like for you?
Again, we were in a place where we were working on our shit and getting our shit together and becoming tight and like just, you know, super real with each other. That shit didn't mean nothing. Wow. Again, it's hard, of course. It's difficult to like, you know, to go through, but the real shit was.
See you swinging the bat in the video?
That was like, yeah.
I don't want to watch that day.
Yeah. I was there the whole time. You know what I'm saying? Like during the tour, the making of the album, the thing. It's like it was therapeutic. You know what I'm saying? It was good. It's good. It's good to deal with your shit. Again, like I said, it's so worth it. Like, you know.
Like that, don't hurt yourself. That was your shit, right? You told me? Don't hurt yourself is the one.
Yeah. How did you guys meet?
Just being out like earlier, like being in the same places, like some Sony events and like doing like an MTV beach something and shit like that. And then like seeing each other and just having conversations from there.
Just being in the business, gotcha.
Yeah.
Obviously, 444, the title track, is like, to me, the climax, the centerpiece of the album. I think No ID said you recorded at the crib on B's mic. You know, like, he said that you were by yourself. Like, what happened next after that? Like,
what do you mean, what happened next, huh?
I mean, obviously you made the record, but he said that, you know, you would have to tell that story about the process of making that song.
Oh, no, I think he pretty much told it. That was how it happened.
Right.
He made a track, and he was, like, looking at me. You know what I'm saying? No ideas that way.
Gotcha.
You know what I'm saying? Like, he's just looking at me like...
just staring at you.
Like, what? What? What you saying? How you feel? Like, what are you talking about?
You ready
about,
to get
man?
Personal?
Yeah.
It's a vulnerable time, like, Jay.
It's like, pretty nice beat, man. Right. I'm going home. He's like, why? He wants to hear it. He wants me. I'm like, no worry, I'm going home.
Wow.
And then I woke up like that morning, like 4:44, right. And I just start, you know, putting in voice notes and shit. And it's better now. I don't have to hold it anymore.
Oh, man.
Yeah, by the way, I didn't have to hold it for all these years. I don't know what I was trying to prove. Like, voice notes.
Is your friend?
Put the shit on the voice note.
Yeah, right.
You know, I hit him. I don't know what time. He probably has the text. I don't know what time it was, maybe 4 something.
No, I think he was talking about Smile with your mother. He had implied that there was a story to Smile that... It was for you to tell the story.
Well, my uncle finished this story. And then, you know, I hit him that morning, like, I got it. And then I went downstairs in the house. Because we was doing the records in United. I started in the house, and then we went to United. But then I went back to the house and did that song in the house.
So, though, really, you feel more comfortable recording it at the house?
I guess, yeah. I didn't even think about it to be a big deal. Like, I just went downstairs and... the next morning, and then called Guru. Guru was there. I mean, obviously, I didn't take myself.
It's like that fucking X-Men house. Everyone's just there, just coming by. And...
you know, professionals. That's what we kept saying. People was walking the studio. Was like, professionals. Yeah.
What was her reaction when she heard it?
I let her tell you that.
Oh.
Yeah.
Fair enough.
Yeah.
But so all the rumors about that there's extra symbolism with the number that was maybe in the bar at the hotel, all of that is BS.
All that.
Oh, it all counts.
No, it's real. We walked by that bar one day. I don't know if I'm supposed to be telling this story. Anyway, we walked by that bar.
We could always cut it.
We was walking. No. It's okay. It's okay. I didn't. And nothing's
Ellie
off.
Asked me. It's his fault.
Obviously, nothing's off limit. Y'all asked me all kind of shit already. And we saw the address and was like, of course.
Oh, after you already had did the song at that time?
No, this is before the song.
Oh, got you.
Way before the song. We just walking in New York. We got like, you know, sometimes we get to like just, which is a treat. Like sometimes people don't like fuck with us and everybody just walking. And we was walking to the west side. I think it was like sunset. We was walking to the west side for, you know, some romantic New York shit. And
Woody Allen
we didn't realize we was on that block. And then we walked past it and we was like, oh shit.
Wow.
Fuck this place.
Like, go in here again.
Of course it's on Ford out.
Yeah, yeah.